everyone would be like, Republic Day hai, dukaan band hai, I think.
According to me, the tractor stands in contrast to the tank.
Yeah, wonderful. Yes. So I would love anyone who watches this video to comment on what they would want Nisha to do in the next video. Like what they want Nisha to talk about. And if they want her to invite me. So please do let me know.
Hello everyone. Welcome to the podcast. Today we have with us Naksos Sherpa. She was a senior of mine in my, you know, in my undergraduate. And she is the best part that happened to me in BHU. The best company I got to have. She believes in starting discourses that are not really brought up in our, in general society, in mainstream society. So she is interested in gender studies. She talks about refugees and minorities. So welcome, Naksos.
Thank you so much, Nisha, for first of all, for all your lovely words. And it's great to be a part of this, whatever you are trying to create via bringing diverse voices. And I hope all the best for the upcoming podcasts as well.
Thank you. Today we'll be talking about the Republic Day Parade and the tractor rally. We will be looking at it through the glasses of how the Republic Day Parade represents nation state and how the tractor rally was an image of what we consider people nation. The layout of the whole conversation will be starting from our personal. We'll talk about our memories of Republic Day, and then we'll come to talk about this year's Republic Day, and then we'll talk about the significance of various symbols that we got to see in the Republic, in the tractor rally, basically why they wanted 26th January and why they wanted tractor and the flag. Okay, so starting with your memories of Republic Day.
I think so. I've never had like very striking memories. I think so. Most of my memories now, because I come from a hill station, so my school, so we didn't have school from December to February. So January 26th would be at home. That is why there wasn't a very active memory. But then I knew it was like a, that was, I think so, one of the memories being connected was most of the shops would be closed. The national anthem and very patriotic songs playing around. And I think so flags being, the flag hoisting that would take place in the ground, one of the grounds in my town. I think so that was one of the most striking feature, and that everyone would be like, Republic Day hai, dukaan band hai. I think so that is one of the things that I remember of Republic Day.
But then if you used to be in your houses, right? So, so did you watch the Republic Day Parade going on Doordarshan?
I think so. I watched, like I used to watch, but because again, no, it used to be winter. And it used to be winters. So yeah, we used to watch it. Like our parents would say, ki now, ujjav, dekhte hain. This is what a Republic Day, and so many tableaus used to come and all, you know, the floats and all. It used to be really brilliant. And then the parade of the whole army and the whole, I think so, the whole get up of the Republic Day used to be very, very avant-garde and very enchanting to the eye of a young child. So I think so that was one of the memories, like discipline, that is discipline organized. And on time, which was so contrary to what I normally see on a day-to-day basis, like how our country used to function. But that day, everyone was in discipline. Everything was tip-top. Everything was perfect to the T. That is what I think I associated with Republic Day Parade in general.
For me, I belong to, like my father is an army. He retired this year, but then he's an army. So our idea of Republic Day and Independence Day and Army Day, all this is very ceremonial, I should say, because we used to wake up early and then many like delicacies were cooked in our houses. And basically, I used to live in army areas. So everyone, like if you knew that Republic Day is going to come, right? Like now that I live in civil, you don't really see the enthusiasm and everything that is related to Republic Day. But and then I went to Army Public School, which was again the whole army thing. So we used to have parades in our schools as well. So that is why most of the time I used to miss the Doordarshan parade, the Republic Day parade. We used to come home only when it was halfway in the middle of it. So we used to be in our schools, and I remember it was in class 11th that I got the opportunity to anchor the parade, that was the school parade. And that was like the moment for me. Because when you hear the drum beats and everything, the energy, what you said about discipline, coordination, everything. And you see the chairman, the commandant coming in, and then people, the whole entourage. It was spectacular. And to be a part of it and to give live commentary on it was something that I used. I remember 1 month earlier, like 1 month prior to the Republic Day, used to have practice. The whole school will be sitting in the ground because our teachers will encourage us to participate in the parade. So we used to, the whole school used to be in the ground, and 50% of the people would be involved in the ceremony somehow or the other, but other 50 will be just bunking the classes or sitting in the ground in the sun doing nothing. See, chilling and all. But then to be involved in that parade and to give the whole anchoring wala jo part tha, that was one among the best moments of my life. And I remember we used to get five rupee kurkure, one laddu and one pastry in a dabba. That used to be our thing, ki dabba lena hai. Bas. And the best part, that because I changed so many schools, different school had different ways of celebrating the Republic Day. So because my father has a transfer, he's an army, so we get transfers every 2-3 years. So in where I am right now, in Danapur, Patna, we used to have Prabhat Feri. It was something like the whole school, along with the teachers, we would circle the school, because not really circle, but then we'll go around the school in lines, much like a contingent, but not that disciplined. We'll simply roam around and we'll shout Bharat Mata Ki Jai and Bande Mataram and Happy Republic Day, long live our republic, things like that. And in that we used to have competition ki kaun zyada zor se chillata hai in between classes. And you used to have placards written Happy Republic Day and things like that. So the whole Republic Day thing was something that we used to wait for. It was something out of the normalcy for us. So yeah.
I think so much of it comes from being an army kid and going to army school. It's just so different for me.
But this year's parade, this year's Republic Day was way too different from either what you experience or what I experienced. So let us talk about that. I'll narrate a very interesting incident. Basically, our teacher, I'm doing cultural studies, so our teachers don't miss out single event when we talk about culture for an assignment. So we had an assignment on Corona, and then we had one assignment on Republic Day as well. Ma'am simply asked us to watch all the tableaus that were coming out, all the contingents and everything, and to write a few sentences on each tableau. What are they representing? How is that related to the culture of that state or that union territory? Everything like that. And in the next class, she was to ask us about that. So in the next class, she asked us, did we see, what did we notice? No one responded. Mom was like, why are you not responding? Did you not see? There was one student who said he didn't see because the tractor rally was much more interesting. And mom asked, why didn't you see? I gave you an assignment on that. And then he said that, but the tractor rally, like the Republic Day parade happens every year. Tractor rally was the new thing, so he was much interested in watching the tractor rally, and so did all of us. and then we talked about tractor rally. We skipped talking about Republic Day parade just a bit on that, but mostly on the tractor rally. So from that, I got this idea of talking about it in this podcast. So how do you see the two parades, Republic Day parade and the tractor parade, if I can say so?
Yeah, I think so. A lot of things were going before the tractor rally, right? News, like reports were coming that, okay, there would be another parallel rally that would come to Delhi. Like they would march, the farmers that are protesting would march towards Delhi during the Republic Day. And I felt, there were a lot of conversations going around in my own peer circles regarding it. Like, how would you see it? Then again, the whole discussion around what is good, what is bad, is it correct, is it not correct, they should be doing, it's about their rights, again, why are they doing in this particular day? And I think just so many of these conversations come into play, right, whenever there is another, I would like to call this the social movement that's going around in our country for a very, the farmers movement is going around in the country for a long time. So I think so. One of the things that I saw was like, okay, this would be a good point of coming in, of their voices being amplified. So this would make the country pause and notice, not just the government, not just the particular states which is concerned, but I think it's a larger part of the country, you know, because again, and like, as you said, your friend who didn't watch the Republic Day Parade, but ended up watching the tractor rally.
The whole class, basically.
A lot of news channels, so many of the news channels just showed the Republic Day Parade. And I think so there was a couple that highlighted the difference between them. In one of the halves, they split the screen, half the screen, we have this whole organized, perfect to the T parade that's happening, organized by the government. And on the other, there's these farmers on tractors shouting slogans or sitting there and coming towards Delhi. And I think so that's a big, and it is organized, but it's not organized in a way that the state
coordinated.
Coordinated in that sense. Like they had their own voice, and I think so I loved the whole. Again, before even I say anything about it, I think so we should be careful in talking about social movements per se. And it's just like a flagging point, right? Because we tend to romanticize a lot of these things. And I think so we have to be careful of not romanticizing it per se. Like this is not a romantic moment for people to view it and say, wow, this is so great. But to keep in mind, okay, this is so great, but what were the causes that led it to this? Right. So we have to be careful again. I think so when these conversations around social movements, and again, when we try to compare and contrast the two movements altogether.
In the class, we were talking about it in terms of Benedict Anderson's essay and Partha Chatterjee's lecture on relativist view of Indian nation, where we talked about how the Republic Day parade is a representation of the nation state. And the people, the tractor rally was about the people nation. I think we need to explain here these two terms in modern context, particularly from the 1970s and 1950s, I should say, after the postmodern. We don't use the word nation simply because when we talk about nation, it is something that has cultural and community affair, something that has to do with common identity between people. Basically, if you talk about our nation, India, our country, India, earlier we were simply either Marathas or we were Bengalis. We were not connected as together because we belong to a certain territory. But then with the rise of nationalism, the whole idea of being sharing a community, of being sharing a territory, came together as we being Indians, we India being a nation. But that was just related to having a certain cultural commons, I should say. But then we were still Indian nation, but British state. We were ruled by the Britishers. But then when we started asking for sovereignty and we became a sovereign, we became a state. And that is how we coined the term nation state. Nation in terms of sharing a certain identity, a common identity, and state in terms of being the sovereign power. So nation state is nation which rules itself, people. But then when we come to people nation, the Partha Chatterjee's lecture is a really great one. I'll link it in the description. If people want to see it, they can see it. It basically talks about how India is not singular, but it is a federation of different nations in terms of different people sharing different communities, having their own idea of what India is. So we talk about how in Bengali, the idea of India is Bharat Mata, a feminine idea of India. But then in Maharashtra, we have Shivaji as the... We have fatherland, or the idea of man as the nation, basically aligning with Shivaji's idea. Maratha idea of nation is more like a Hindutva idea. Basically, Partha Chatterjee elaborates on all these different... he talks about Punjab, he talks about Assam, Tamil Nadu, and various other states, and how their idea of nation differs from the nation state, that is the singular idea of nation, the totalitarian idea of nation, if we can say so. So it is here that we see that different people have their own idea of nation, and that is what we call people nation. In the Republic Day Parade and Tractor Rally, Republic Day Parade was a state-sponsored event. And seriously, I was amazed when I saw there was a report which said that in 2014, we spent more than, the state spent more than 330 crores on a single Republic Day celebration. And of course, it would have increased by 2021, but then it was shocking to me, 330 on a single day. Crore that too. But yeah, that was a nation-sponsored program, or where all the ideas of the tableaus and the contingents align with nation's idea of the state's idea of the nation. Many times we don't recognize ourselves with that, but the tractor rally was a representation of people nation, where they are talking about the things in contemporary India that are problem of the people and how they want to represent themselves in the foreground.
And I think, so Nisha, you brought like an important distinction between like the nation state and the people nation. I think so. While I've gone through Benedict Anderson's book of the imagined communities, but not Father Chatterjee's lecture, but from what you said, I think so it becomes really important to understand these concepts, right? Because of the heterogeneity that we exist in, like there is no singular nation that I look at. The way you must, you sitting in a particular state, the way you view because of your social, cultural, economic, political backgrounds and leanings, the nation, it's completely different from how I would view it according to my own social cultural context and experiences that my community might have faced, right? And I think it becomes very important to view it in that sense. And also the fact that you just emphasized on people nation, I think so what the farmers and the tractor rally is basically about people. I think so. Treading on a very thin line between the speech, how it's been curtailed in our country right now, I think so it gives hope. The farmers' movement is a hope that people's voices will not be suppressed. I think so that is what democracy is all about, right? It's about the people. It's not about the state. It's not supposed to be about the state. It's about the people. And I think so they are the embodiment of what democracy is. I think so that is one of the most...
Yeah, I was just going through the word republic, and it has a Latin origin where republic basically means people think, public think, something that is people. But then I saw how slowly and slowly our whole Republic Day has transformed into state, basically. Republic Day is the day when we became a state. From being a nation, we became a state. But then it was mostly, it has to be people about public, Republic. But then through and through years, I saw that when Raj 1850, we had our first Republic Day celebration, it didn't have to do much with military power and all these tableaus. There was no tableau that time. But then slowly and slowly, the Republic Day became something. It became very doctrined, if I can say so. And everything that happened in the Republic Day was very well written. And a pura planned, basically. Something that is not people. People are random. People are, people are lively. And but the Republic Day became so much about discipline and organization and coordination that it became almost like machinery. And that is when we lost the connect between people and nation, and we simply became a state. And if you talk about simply how we use the Republic Day to show our military might.
Yes,
exactly. That has to do with fostering the nationalist feeling, but then it also has to show the neighbors. We are ready to wage a war, basically. We are saying we have all the might that is necessary and we are ready to wage a war. That has to do with the military. But when it comes to the tableaus are concrete. They are 3D models. Most of them don't have much of motion. And the motion is there only by the people who surround it. Jo side mein dance karte hain, ya fir the people who are on the tableau and they do something. But then their motions are also repetitive. Ek hi step ko baar baar kar rahe hain till the time they cross the whole Rajpath. So, yahan pe bhi their motions are not really motions. It is more like machine na, ki jo chale ja rahe hai ghari ke tarah. And there too, we don't see people there. So I think that the tableaus are a fixation or of something that is of a freezed moment that has no life in it. It is basically a fixed, privileged and hegemonic cultural representation.
It definitely does have. And some particular states did bring up tableaus of some particular temples, which was already controversy. And it does send a message, right? Tableaus are representation of a state. So when a tableau is coming with, when the float is coming with particular temples that's been in the news for the longest period of time, it does send a message to a particular community that what's happening. Right. And I think so what you are saying is exactly that. It becomes like a repetitive motion as well as very, very hegemonic in that sense. Like trying to emphasize not on the heterogeneity of that state, but then, yeah, it does send some particular messages. And I do agree with it. So, yeah.
And many times we see, like I was reading the bulletin of what rules and regulations of how the tableaus can be to all the other states and the ministries for their participation. Constantly, they use the word authentic, that the tableau should be authentic to the union territory or the state it is representing. And I was just wondering, what did the word authentic mean here? Because many times, the kind of people who are on the tableaus or around the tableaus are not people whom we really see in a society. Wo koi traditional sa kapde pehen rakhe, which we don't normally wear. How is that authentic? But then I realized that the authentic hair means authoritative or something that has to do with verified or something that can be, that cannot be questioned. And thus an identity that has been hegemonized in people as this is what this state means. So, or fir uske baad us type ke kapde pehen ke, you are again reinforcing that idea jo already aapke hegemonized hai, and then you are again reinforcing it, but then you don't really see it in in practicality, in real life.
We have a certain depiction, like tableaus are a certain depiction of a certain, like what you said, just repeating, right? It's a certain depiction of a certain community. So if West Bengal comes, like brings in a tableau, for supposing, it's not going to show the Nepali people who have a huge population in North Bengal. They won't show the Lepcha tribes out there, right? Because Bengal would be completely associated with the Bengali ethnic, socio-cultural, linguistic group, right? So I think, so it, again, what you are saying is that the tableau reifies the whole idea of our state. So what that state is and the stereotyped image of the state. And I'm not saying that showing your culture is wrong or bad. That is not, I think, what we are talking about, right, Nisha? Just to be clear to the people who might be listening to it, we are not saying it's wrong or bad. We are just saying it's that sometimes even in tableaus, what becomes reified is the whole idea of the homogenization. There's a homogenization of the state that is being reified again and again with every parade. That the minority communities, that the minority groups will never be a representation within the tableau itself. It will always be the dominant group. And I think so right now in our country, we need to question these practices. Especially now because it sends a message to the larger group. Everyone who is aware knows of the environment that our country right now is dealing with, right? We are not living in a pond, or we are not living in a bubble without no political processes taking place at all. And I think so when we are talking about these issues, a lot of movements happening around, it becomes very important for the states to send in messages or like how you represent, because symbolism does play a large, large, large part in how the state functions or how the nation state functions, because they grasp the attention of the people through those particular symbolisms, where symbolism now becomes more important than the people itself.
So we were just elaborating on what we see in Republic Day. Now, if you contrast it with the tractor rally, that would be a better study, because in tractor rally, you see there were women, there were men, there were people of all socioeconomic background on the tractors doing all sorts of things. And you see the diversity here in comparison to the Republic Day parade, which was highly mechanical and highly stereotypical, hegemonized. The tractor rally is basically, to me, in a statement against this freezed idea of nation and state. The tractor rally is the lively, energetic, contemporary idea of nation, where they're talking about things that matter to them at this particular time and period. And that was really interesting to note. And if you see the motion too, the motion here was not organized, mechanized. It was the general flow of things happening. And though we'll talk about the violence that erupted, but if you simply talk about how the whole idea of it, it is basically something that we never really saw in our nation.
I think one of the main, as you said, right, about the image that comes from the media of how the tractor rally was being. And I think so what it shows us was the diversity of our country and is in contrary to the mechanization that the state wants us to go in a particular direction. The randomness of it, of how the people were walking, the freedom in how some were sitting on a tractor, some were sitting, some were doing something else. And the diversity that it represented was something of a larger scale, right? And then the whole idea that they were doing it not for themselves or to show that how for their own rights, for particular aim that they had, the movement had. I think so that becomes very, very crucial for us to actually appreciate what they were trying to do out there. And then again, understand how it stands against the Republic Day parade altogether. It is in contrast to the Republic Day. We cannot, like, there is no similarity between the Republic Day parade at all with what. This was purely done, whereas you did state, quote the numbers about the expenses that it's done, the expenses of the Republic Day parade, of the taxpayers' money. And on the other hand, the structural rally is what is our country made up of. it's made up of the farmers. We survive because of the farmers. And I think so it becomes a very strong symbol where we talk about Jai Jawan, Jai Kisan. And I think so. I think one was about Jai Jawan and the other one was about Jai Kisan. The ones who feed us, right? The ones who feed the whole nation.
That was so nicely put. Republic Day was about Jawan and this was about Kisan. Yeah, and basically this is what the 26th January was important for. The tractor rally has had to happen on the 26th January because it has to stand in contrast to the state-sponsored Republic Day parade. Has it been any other day? I don't think it would have had that much of an impact that it had being on 26th January. Okay, now coming to why the tractors.
I think so a lot of about the sequence of the events, what happened, what didn't happen. I think so that I do not want to elaborate on that because there are again a lot, there are so many parts of a whole story, right? Mm-hmm. And I cannot just give importance to one part of the story while ignoring the other. Despite me knowing that certain parts might be totally not correct at all, might be false, just to give this this podcast, and I'm not saying that we are taking a political stand out here as well. I think so, Nisha and I, we are not taking a political stand as well, because right now it's not the time to become that as well. I think so it would be very incorrect and very, very cushioned and privileged of us not to talk about it and to give our voice, to lend our voices to things that actually matter. But I think so, we shouldn't be going into the details of what happened, what occurred, what didn't occur. I think so there is plenty of resources. We should link all the resources that there is. There is a podcast by this Indian Express around it. There are newspaper articles around it. And I think so they should give a clear idea of what they have in front of them, like choosing to believe a story. And I think so we also need to be very critical of what we try to see, right? Because there is one part of the media that's to show us other images of what the tractor rally is about. It was about the violence that was created, the ruckus created by the farmers. While on the other hand, it was about the police violence, right? Now, I'm not saying that. Now, when we talk about violence per se, I think so I was reading this particular book by Paulo Freire, and it's called Pedagogy of the Oppressed. And I think so I'd want to quote what he says in the book, just to give the listeners a bit of background when we talk about violence and to understand it in a contextual sense, like when violence happens and when there is a power dynamic in who is doing that violence against whom. I think so the power dynamics are very clear for the viewers, until and unless you want to ignore those power dynamics, that's another question. So it's from page number 29. So just, this is the book, Pedagogy of the Oppressed, from which I'm reading from. So never in history has violence been initiated by the oppressed. Never in history has violence been initiated by the oppressed. How could they be the initiators if they themselves are the result of violence? How could they be the sponsors of something whose objective inauguration called forth their existence as oppressed? There would be no oppressed had there been no prior situation of violence to establish the subjugation. I think of this line, there would be no oppressed had there been no prior situation of violence to establish their subjugation. Violence is initiated by those who oppress, who exploit, who fail to recognize others as persons, not by those who are oppressed, exploited, and unrecognized. It is not the unloved who initiate disaffection, but those who cannot love because they love only themselves. It is not the helpless, subject to terror, who initiate terror, but the violent who with their power create the concrete situation which begets the rejects of life. It is not the tyrannized who initiate despotism, but the tyrant. It is not the despised who initiate hatred, but those who despise. It is not those whose humanity is denied them, who negate humankind, but those who denied that humanity. So that is one verse that really, really touched my heart. And I was reading it during the rally, and apparently this was what was the news was showing what was happening all around. And when I came across this verse, I think it really reverberated with what is actually happening right now. That there was some situation of violence. There were situation of oppression, subjugation. That is why the whole tractor rally happened. It was not out of nowhere. So the reasons were created. Certain reasons, certain environment, certain laws were created for those farmers to take this step, where they've abandoned their homes, where they've come far from their homes, sitting in those chilly winters throughout home states, protesting in those borders, and right now and walking or like sitting on the tractors and coming to the city. Right? I think so there was some situation that was being created for these things to happen. And I think so just to speak in terms of a very, very narrow idea of just the violence, of just that moment, the momentary violence that took place. So I think so that would be wrong of us to judge a movement or for people to prejudice, stereotype any movement without understanding what were the situations, what were the laws that were created, without understanding their pains, without understanding how the state, the government has created situations, the environment of oppression for them to take that step. We have never seen farmers doing this to this extent, right?
Like, yeah.
Have seen farmers. Now, this would be completely wrong. We have seen multiple times how the farmers have protested time and again, but their voices have never been heard on a national scale. And especially, we will see, just a quick Google search of farmers' protests around India will give you various images of farmers from South India coming, where they have put mice in their mouths to protest against certain laws, for them to reject because of the injustices that happened to them, or the very long march that happened in Maharashtra, where they walked miles and miles to protest against the injustices. I think it would be very wrong to say that this was only the movement, but I think so what this is getting is the international media's attention. It is getting people from different corners of the country that were unaware of what was happening. And especially when this is happening in such a massive scale for such a long time. Now, I think so it's very important for us to understand and not see it through a very narrowed vision of just the violence. Just the violence. That shouldn't be just our focus. I think so it would be very wrong and unjust of us to look at it in that way and to contextualize the whole movement of why it happened altogether. I think so that is very important for us to understand. And for the listeners, to know what is and not to bring a very narrow point of view to what the violence is about.
Yeah, about the strong, powerful words that you read. There was this line that I heard, which Martin Luther King spoke in response to a riot that erupted in USA. Black people were rioting in USA. And in response to this, he says, he condemns riot. He says violence is wrong, everything that Martin Luther King stands for. But then he does say that these situations are created, constructed in USA such that the black people are forced to adopt violence and to choose to be violent. Violence is not a natural state. He said, and I quote, "Riot is the language of the unheard." And this is so well put in our current context. They have been sitting for months now, and still, if the center, if the state chooses to unsee and unhear these people, what other choice are we leaving them with? And I see that in democracy, we have a very idealized image of a protester. The protester is already in some way on the lower grounds, because he is the one protesting against someone who is in status quo. But we expect him to behave a certain way, to be non-violent, to listen to what people are saying, to listen to what authorities are saying. We put them on a pedestal of how they should be by romanticizing the whole idea. So we have our own history of satyagrahas and all, and we compare them with that. Ki unhone aisa kiya tha, you could have also done that. How can you be so? And that everything puts the pressure on the protester not on the authorities. And this is where we see how the hierarchies are created and how they are more and more reinforced.
And I think so all winters in Delhi they have had like protests continuously, right? And I think so I'm trying to say is this, whatever the whole conversation is located in certain political context.
Mm-hmm.
That is the reason why people are protesting. It's women protesting for extension of hostel day or hostel deadlines, to protesting for or against certain laws, be it the Trans Act, be it the Citizenship Amendment Act, be it the Farmers Laws, right? I think so. There's been continuous protest against certain laws in our country, and we have to understand like what has made people go to a certain extent, and we need to take a stand. We need to understand these things and not be blinded by what the state is showing us. Like, we cannot, that is not how democracy works, and that is not how we as humans have to understand. We cannot just see one narrative and paint a picture out of it. I think so. What basically we are trying to do is just problematize the idea for people in their heads that, okay, this is what it is. You need to problematize a lot of things. Like, the state is painting this beautiful picture of the how the farmer will profit from it. And I think if you are giving into it without thinking about, okay, the farmer, the state is presenting this. Now, when the state is presenting it in such a pretty picture of how the protest will look at, I'm thinking the contrary, that, okay, they are painting this pretty, pretty picture of the farmer. But the farmer is there in conditions where the farmers themselves are protesting against this particular picture that's been painted. So whose voice do we give importance? But I think so, we spoke a lot about a lot of issues for people to actually think and ponder upon. I think so, what we are pushing to do them is not say, okay, what I am saying is absolutely correct. What you are saying is absolutely true. And you just hear what I am saying. We are not doing that. We are allowing them to think in terms of other ideas, right? What you said. Just think a bit differently. Question it.
Be critical.
Yes. Just be critical. Let's not go as herds into one homogeneous thing. We are heterogeneous individuals with completely different points of view in life. And I think so, where we also come from, like, again, no, because we've studied humanity, so we know how these things work. We understand because maybe of our own educational backgrounds, we are able to speak here. And I think so what you're doing is just using your platform to make people think in a certain direction. Okay, this is there, you believe in. Look at this, compare these two and think clearly now.
We were talking about why did they have to use the tractor particularly? According to me, the tractor stands in contrast to the tank.
Yeah. Wonderful. Yes. Yes.
Again, as you said, Republic Day was for the Jawans and the tractor rally was for the Kisan. So Jawan has their tanks and so Kisans have their tractor. And tractor represents productivity and it represents growth. It represents prosperity. Whereas tank represents destruction. See the tractor a response to the figure of violence or an oppressed reply to the oppressor. It symbolizes a certain affluence because not all farmers can afford to own a tractor. And also the tractor is their mode of sustenance, not just in the fields, but on the border as well, because they used to sleep inside the tractor. So they used to have a canvas or a plastic wrap on the roofs of the tractor. And then they used to sit asleep inside at night. And so that was their shelter, something that they couldn't find on the borders. And it was basically much like they brought all their houses along with them on the borders. And they knew their hope that they will survive there was because they had the tractors with them. And so to use it for the rally, to say that we are independent enough, we do not want you to provide us with shelter and we'll use it, but then we want you to listen to us listen to our demands because you are in power and it's your job to actually listen to us. Yeah, so I think that was the importance of tractor. Anything that you would like to add?
I think so, Nisha, you like said everything that there is to be said. Like, I think so, you've from people, nation to nation state to the symbolism of the parades, the two rallies altogether, one a parade, one a rally. Even the language that we use, that one, we are seeing it as a parade, a show, a rhetoric of the parade that there was. And the other is a rally, a commonly used term. And even the language surrounds the parade is different from the language that we used to describe the rally. To the violence that occurred, like not going into the nuances of violence, but then contextualizing the violence about what is... to think more in terms of how, whose turn are we talking about? And lastly, when you talk about, again, coming back to the symbolism of the tractor, right? Where one of the tractor is a non-violent, it symbolizes non-violence. It symbolizes, again, what you problematize that, okay, not everyone owns a tractor as well. So again, the things that you mentioned, and again, the tank that is representative of the army, that's, and tank in no way symbolizes non-violence or peace. Tanks are used for destruction. So I think so there was a lot of symbolism. And I think so to understand the larger body politics, I think that's very crucial right now. Like when we talk about these issues, whatever, it's not just one instance. This just didn't come out of nowhere. It wasn't just a one-time thing. And it's not that after the 26th, everything's been gone back to normalcy. No, things have escalated. So many things have happened. There has been data given about so many of the farmers dying. So I think so what I'd like at the end of the day is listeners to listen to us, not to listen to what our podcast is about. It's about problematizing our notions. And while I hope we have taken a stance through it, I hope through your platform, we are amplifying whatever is happening around the country and more issues that we need to talk about. And it's not just one instance of these three laws that's come into play, but about a larger politics that's going around our country and maybe the world at large. Right. But in our country, specifically, that directly affects us. And I think so the farmers are the symbol of resistance. Resistance against whatever is bad. They are a symbol, they symbolize people. They symbolize everything that's good. For me, they are symbolizing everything that's good. And for me, they are symbolizing the power of the people right now. And like so many of others have said, that if this now they are going to assume a certain extent, if this fails, then I don't know whether there will be another social movement that will succeed. If this fails.
Yeah, exactly. The whole hope of our nation continuing to be a democratic republic is in this farmers' protest, according to me. But then I think it will be incomplete. Or else we'll have like people will be putting down in comment sections ki flag ke baare mein baat nahi kiya tum logon ne.
Yeah, and flag nahi baat kiya, because I think so the flag has been spoken about, and yeah. I think so what they're trying to do is not break farmers rally and make a comparative study. We are not doing a have comparisons, but what we are trying to say is we are not doing a comparative study. The reason that Nisha brought me was just to bring another perspective into it. Not for me to make a comparative study if each and everything has happened. I think so people, what we are trying to do is push people to think in a certain direction. To think away from what the media is trying to do, majority of the media. And when we look at small independent media houses, that report from the ground, I think so it's time for us to lend our ears to those type of media houses. For us to understand, okay, we are talking about the flag le raya, nahi le raya, kya hua, nahi hua, kaun mara, kisne mara. And I think so these are the nuances that journalist people do. And I'm no journalist to say, comment on it. But I think we have done enough of what we stand for, and enough of the symbolism has already spoken about. Where now that symbolism of be it the flag, be it the Republic Day, of the nation has taken more importance than the people and their injustices altogether.
Exactly. Flag has been talked about a lot. We just wanted to talk about things that haven't been talked of. So when people have already talked about why farmers shouldn't use 26th January for their protest, where they said that 26th January represents our nation, and then it represents a certain image of our nation to the international audience or the international spectators, it was important for us to bring into context why 26th January is important for the farmers to organize their rally. And we talked about the symbolism of tractor, which no media houses are talking about. Flag has been taken care of by the media a lot. And it has been used to actually deconstruct the whole rally, to put it into a negative picture. But yeah, let's not go there. So to end this whole podcast, I think we need to understand that the Republic Day is not simply a day for us to remember the sovereignty of our nation, but to understand what sovereignty means. It means that the people of the nation rule the nation. The Republic Day isn't simply about military might or the state-sponsored picture of the nation, but it is about the birth of the Republic as a constituent body. It's about the common will of the people, and it's about a certain spirit of recognition that I think the public symbolizes humanity to me.
And also this Republic Day was about resistance to hegemony, resistance against oppression, and resistance against laws which have not taken account into people's voices from the grassroots. I think so that was Republic Day for me. And that is what the farmers' movement will be for me for the longest time, without, again, being careful of not romanticizing any movement. I think so that is one of the murky things that we need to be careful about, not romanticizing it, but then to be hopeful about change, to be hopeful that things will change with people's power. I think that gives us this hope. The Republic Day, the tractor rally at large was about resistance and hope.
Yeah. <For the future.
laughs> Hopefully. Hoping that. Yeah.
Thank you so much for the whole conversation. It was so insightful, and I really loved talking to you. I could take it for another hour, but then
I just loved it. I am so happy that you're doing this. So whatever this community that you are creating, and I have watched your previous videos, and it has been lovely, insightful to the readers. And I think so your podcast, whatever, you're trying to take this into a new direction. While you are talking about academia and academics per se, the other question, the other conversation is about these political issues, not all political issues, but then you are talking about a variety of issues, right? And being diverse voices.
But and then everything is political. Yeah, so
everything is political, exactly. And I think so I would love anyone who watches this video to comment on what they would want Nisha to do in the next video. Like what they want Nisha to talk about. And if they want her to invite me. So please do let me know.
I have so many topics planned for you. I want you to speak in all these topics. I'll send you another email. I don't know if this will ever end. But thank you so much for joining. To the viewers who are watching this, Nansel has her own website called the pomelo.co.in. There they have such great articles. If you start reading them, I don't think you'll end, like, you'd like to close them. You'll be less likely to close it, because the kind of discourses that the website is trying to generate and the kind of things they talk about is something that you won't normally find the mainstream or the mainstream is privileged to me. But yeah, you won't find other people talk about. But it's just really important for your critical thinking, for your personality development, according to me. Because in this day and age, if you choose not to read politics and not to involve yourself in politics, I don't think you can survive. That's not education, according to me. Education demands you to be vocal, demands you to be aware of things that are going around you. So I would demand you to go check her website, thepomelo.co.in. I'll put a link to it in the description. Go see it, watch it, read it. And yeah, thank you. thank you for watching this.
Thank you again.
Bye-bye.